When Dee and I were talking about having a chapel fest at the church, actually it was Dee's idea, it says you gotta do Taste My Jesus. Taste My Jesus is a story that has some fact to it and maybe a little bit of fiction if you look it up on Snopes or other sites. It takes place at the Chicago Divinity School at something that is always called Baptist Day. And in the spring, they would invite a theologian to come and speak, and students and others would assemble on a large hill and have lunch, like an outdoor revival to speak. One of the members of the faculty at Chicago Divinity School was Reverend Dr. Paul Tillich. And Dr. Tillich is credited, rightly so, for much of the theology that we have, and he wrote many books. But it happens that he, like some Christians, did not believe specifically in the resurrection of Christ. That's important to the story. Another person that's very important to the story is an African-American preacher that happened to be in attendance. Now, it is my experience in life that African-American pastors have a great power to their speaking. Sadly, because many of their foremothers and forefathers were denied freedom, that all they had was Christ, and Christ became very central to their lives. Keep that in mind as you hear this story. So Reverend Tillich is addressing this large audience on this grassy knoll in the spring at Chicago Divinity School. And he's quoting scholar after scholar and book after book, explaining that the resurrection was nothing more than emotional mumbo jumbo, and that in fact Christ never could have risen from the dead. After about 30 seconds, an older African-American preacher stood up from the back of the auditorium because Dr. Tillich had asked if there was any questions. He said, "Dr. Tillich, I have just one question." And he reached into his sack and he took out an apple. And he started eating it. He was crunching and munching on the apple. And he said, "I've never read all those fancy books that you have read. I don't know anything about those theologians you have lifted up." But as he was finishing his apple, he said, "I just got one question for you, Dr. Tillich. Is this apple that I'm eating, is it bitter or is it sweet?" Dr. Tillich, being a very righteous man, said, "I cannot possibly know whether your apple is bitter or sweet because I have never tasted your apple." To which the African-American preacher says, "And it's quite obvious that you have never tasted my Jesus either." To which it is said the 1,000 plus that were in attendance broke out into applause, and Dr. Tillich promptly left the stage. If you look it up, there is some truth to that, and maybe a little bit of fiction. Now, Paul, in our scripture that Sister Jan read today, is in prison when he writes to his friends at Philippi saying, "Don't give up and the joy of the Lord. Be joyous in your communications together. As our praise team said, let nothing steal your joy, even when people are trying to put you down. So here's Paul, that because of the disruptive power of the cross, because of the resurrection power, is in prison. Yet he's still saying, don't give up your joy, the joy that comes from Christ. Maybe reclaiming a bit of the disruptive power of the cross, the radical love of Christ, is just what the world needs today. I believe it was last Monday, I heard on the morning news that it was National Cheeseburger Day. And I got thinking, sometimes he tells me I think too much, but I got thinking, why don't we have a National God Day? So I found a picture of a cheeseburger and I posted it on Facebook and I just asked the question, why don't we have a National God Day? Not everybody likes cheeseburgers, not everybody likes God. And of course, some replied, well, you know, we do have Christmas and we do have Easter. And there's a certain truth to that, but I don't know if they rise to being a nationally acclaimed day anymore. You might argue that maybe National Cheeseburger Day is more widely accepted. But anyways, a member of Pine Grove United Methodist Church, Danielle Laraway, Sue Solomon's daughter, Dottie's granddaughter, wrote a reply. And it really struck me, and I asked her if I could share it today, and she said, by all means. So she's responding to National Cheeseburger Day. And she said, that is the problem, Al. Too many people want to customize God's lesson the same way they customize a cheeseburger. So we can't select a dollar menu order of salvation from the drive-thru menu, we choose to worship at home. It takes a little effort to come to church on a hot, sticky day or a cold day in the middle of winter to maybe be friendly to someone that we're not particularly friendly with anymore. But the joy of the Lord in Christ calls us to do that, calls us to be here for a pep rally so that we can face the rest of the week. A little later in the week, I posted something else about a parody about people that are church shopping, kind of like house hunters, actually. Dee, I put that on Facebook. And Danielle responded to that. She says, yeah, Al, I like that 2:15 service. That would work good for me if we could have church at 2:15. You know, it would work really well for some people if we had church at 8 o'clock. That would work great for me. But for some, it's 10:30. For others, it would probably be 2:15, and for some, it would probably be 9:30 at night. But that's just not really practical. And if you want me to be a pastor for very long. But anyways, it's about that customization that so many people want today, rather than combining and being part of something bigger and being part of the body of Christ. Reverend Penny Brink of Round Lake and Malta Ridge United Methodist Church shared a poem about having $3 worth of Christ, or God, and when Danielle spoke about having a dollar cheeseburger, this one came to mind. This poem was written by Wilbur Reese. It's short, goes like this. I would like $3 worth of God, please. Not enough to explode my soul or disturb my sleep, but just enough to equal a warm cup of milk or a snooze in the sunshine. I don't want enough of God to make me love someone that doesn't look like me or pick beets with a migrant, I want ecstasy, not transformation. I want the warmth of a womb, not rebirth. I want a pound of the eternal in a paper sack. I would like $3 of God, please. End of quote. So many today do not want that disruptive power of Christ that Paul was talking about, that leads to a joy that is so deep, that is so profound, that we cannot help share it with one another, cannot help share it with the world that so desperately needs it. Two more quick illustrations. Some in my household like to watch Say Yes to the Dress. So, in the interest of community, I watch that too sometimes. If you're not familiar with that program, it is brides picking out their wedding dress and all the joy and drama that goes along with that. And one bride was talking about her wedding theme and her dress, and she said, "And we're really looking forward to the wedding because it's going to be a beer-themed wedding." And she went on at great lengths about the beer-themed wedding. I'm not opposed to people having a good time and having a little libation at a wedding, but I did find it a little bit odd that that was the theme of the whole wedding, was beer. One final illustration. My mother-in-law is a Methodist preacher up north by Malone in Chattagang, Greensville. And she had the kids up front for puzzle the pastor or whatever, and they were talking about Jesus. And she had some parents come up to her after the service and say, "We don't want our kids hearing about that Jesus stuff. We're bringing them up to find their own God. So we don't want them to be hearing about Jesus." I don't know about you, but when I go to a Chinese restaurant, I expect to have wonton or egg drop soup, not New England clam chowder. We're about Jesus. That's why we're here. We are the church of Jesus Christ. We come together to receive his joy, to receive his love, from which nothing can separate us. And maybe, just maybe, that can be a disruptive power in our lives, as it was for those early believers. Let us pray. Loving God, may your love disrupt our comfortable lives. Part of our first world problems is we just get a little too complacent and take things for granted and want to pick you up in the drive-thru window. May your great disruptive power move us and transform us into a different place, where we can share your love and joy and hope and peace with the world and communities that so desperately need it. It is our prayer in your name. Amen.